Namaste. All right. So today's talk is very interesting. I'm actually very happy that I'm doing this talk today. My guest today is Shashikala Anant. I'm going to tell you guys a bit about Shashikala first, and then obviously I'll let you know what the talk is about too. By the time I'm done with the introduction, you'll know what it is about. So Shashikala holds a degree in architecture from the School of Architecture, Madras University. She has researched the Indian classical Indian science of architecture, Vastu, which the talk is about today, for over 30 years. From 1982 to 1992, she was a student of Sri V. Ganapati Sthapati, a leading authority on the Vastu Shastras, from whom she learned both textual knowledge and practical field application. She was part of a team that made the 1991 award-winning film, A Shilpi Speaks, that explains the tradition of the sculptor. Her books on Vastu include The Indian Tradition of Design based on Vastu Shastra, The Penguin Guide to Vastu, and Vastu, A Path to Harmonious Living. She also translated Sri Ganapati Sthapati's book on econometry, Shirpa Chennul, from Tamil to English under the title Pratima Mana Lakshanam. Shashikala has studied the Vastu text extensively, assimilating traditional wisdom and exploring its field application. She and her husband, Raghu Anantanarayanan, whom has been on my podcast twice, and I'm really proud about it, have been students of yoga and Vedanta for the last 35 years. This combination of yoga, Vastu, and Vedanta have helped them to move into a position of mentoring young minds to understand and reflect upon the wisdom of the Indian tradition. They now live in the Nilgiris. By the way, you have to see where they stay. It's an amazing place to hang out. Where they are setting up a meditation center in a small village close to Kotagiri, and where Shashikala works on projects incorporating the wisdom of Vastu in creative and harmonious ways with the modern lifestyle. So Shashikala, thanks a lot for agreeing to come and chat with me. Welcome to the podcast.
Wow, great. Wonderful, Kushal.
So Shashikala, first things first, I wanted to ask you a question, because a lot of time, you know, people talk about Vastu Shastra in India, and Vastu Shastra, as a layman would understand today, is literally reduced to, you call someone to your house, that somebody says, oh, you break this wall, or you do this, or you put this artifact over here, or you put something over there, and it ends there. But nobody knows the history of Vastu Shastra. How has this, means or acquiring knowledge, or, you know, a way of looking at the world come about? So could you first start with, you know, telling people a bit of the history of Vastu Shastra, how it comes about, which community in India actually takes care of it, and what is the present status when it comes to that community?
It's a very long-winded explanation I'm going to take you through, because we are talking about one of the oldest histories in India. Because all of human settlement, whether you're talking about individual houses, or you're talking about a village or a town, or you're talking about religious centers or spiritual centers, all of this came into the purview of the Vastu Shilpa Shastra. That was the original name, Vastu Shilpa Shastra. And if you take it word by word, Vastu is a derivative of Vas. Vas means to live in. And it also means Vastu, and Vastu is a thing or a material object. Vastu is the space it inhabits. So Vastu literally means architecture, spatial configuration. Shilpa means form. So Vastu Shilpa Shastra means the relationship between form and built space. So everything that comes into the purview of form and built space is part of Vastu Shilpa Shastra. So traditionally, there were five types of people within this Vastu group, Shilpis. They are known as Manu, Maya, Tvashta, Shilpi, and Vishwagnya. Out of these, they were blacksmiths, goldsmiths, stone craftsmen, wood craftsmen, and designers. So all these design elements of any community or any settlement in India came under the purview of the Shilpis. their community. So traditionally, they lived in smaller collectives, just like every other community has. And invariably, they were on the outer periphery of a town or a village, because they did a lot of metal work, and which meant that they also had fires burning. So all their work was in the, if there is a five or a seven prakara, prakara means surrounding settlement. If there were five or seven prakaras to a village or a town, they would probably be in the sixth or the seventh, which is where they made vessels for cooking, agricultural implements, implements for warfare. They made sculptural icons. They made wooden craft items. They also created buildings. So all this came under the purview of the Vastu Shilpi. And if you look at the historical evidence, it comes from the Atharvana Veda. The Atharvana Veda actually talks about what is known as Gandharva Veda, all the aesthetic traditions. So music, dance, sculpture and architecture come under the Gandharva Veda. And if you want to look at physical evidence, you have Buddhist monographs and texts which talk about iconometry and iconography, which probably goes back to 5th, 6th century BC. But very important thing that you need to remember, Kushal, is that historically, the written record is a much later event. Earlier, it was always oral transference of knowledge. You probably know about it, but most people don't seem to understand the significance of this. It means that the practical application comes before and the written record comes later. So today you find many scholars breaking their heads with the Vastu Shilpa texts. They don't realize the texts are incomplete because they were not the main carriers of the knowledge. The main carriers of the knowledge were the people. It went from father to son, uncle to nephew, and they learned how to use material in a way that would be economical, it would be elastic. They learned to use material in a very plastic or elastic manner, which is why you find these amazing skills where you have this monolith lion with a ball in the mouth. It's a very famous cultural masterpiece. The ball actually moves freely within the teeth. You can put a stick through and move it. And the whole thing is one rock, which has been carved with this amazing relationship between the moving thing in between. This is what you find in metallic and plastic toys today. Can you imagine doing it carefully with a chisel and the hammer for several weeks or several months until you can achieve this amazing craft where there is a loose ball within the mouth of a lion and you can actually move it with your finger. So this kind of incredible craft or capability is part of a transference of knowledge in the field, in the yard. And only then the textual knowledge was learned. So traditionally, what is known as the parampara siksha. Parampara siksha is in each of the traditions. In music, parampara siksha will be with the tanpura, where you're listening to sound. In the parampara siksha of a dancer, primarily would be to work with the body. The parampara siksha in a shilpi is in the yard, working with materials, right? It can be wood, stone, or it can be with molten metal, where you learned how to create metallic icons in what is known as panchaloha. Panchaloha means the five metals.
Okay.
And usually it has copper, tin, zinc, a little bit of silver, and a little bit of gold. Okay. Yeah. These metals, which have different melting points, all done in the backyard of a Shilpi's house, even today. One doesn't know what they use to be able to smelt it and to be able to pour it together without cracks, without fissures in the lost wax process. You can still see it. We actually showed this whole process in the film which we made in 1991. Similarly, stone. The attitude with which the stone is chosen, brought to the yard, cut, put together and finally placed in the sanctum, there is a tremendous sacredness to this whole procedure. Similarly, also with wood. So you have records that the traditional Shilpi of hundreds and hundreds of years ago was actually the caretaker of the forest. The carpenter was the caretaker of the forest. He held the Samhita known as Vana Samrakshana Samhita, which means he took care of the forest. He said which was the time when you could cut, which were the times you could not touch the wood because it was regenerating, which woods could be removed, which were too young and you don't take them out. So we are talking about an inherently hands-on tradition, one, and two, they throughout the history of India, the Stapati, the Shilpi community, have been free people. They were never controlled by the empire. Throughout, the kings did not own them. Like many others, the state owned them. These were part of a guild. So which means that if a particular Rajya, if there is a particular state where there was no building activity happening, they pulled their tools and they moved to another state where their reception was better, their patronage was better, more opportunities. So which is why you find so much similarity between certain kinds of masterpieces, certain kinds of great monuments in certain parts of the country. It is not because we have this foolish way of explaining historical masterpieces. We'll say it was done by Ashoka, as if Ashoka sat down on the ground and sculpted a temple. It's such a stupid thing to say. The reality is these master sculptors and these master craftsmen moved from place to place, and which is why you found similarities between Madhya Pradesh and Orissa. You found similarities between Maharashtra, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. It was the same craftspeople moving from the times of the Rashtrakutas to the Vijayanagara and then to the Pandya kingdom. So you have this movement of enormously skillful people. One of the things I like to say is that if you look at the great traditions of the early years of the cave temples, which was probably the original of all architectural and sculptural work, the lot of people talk about, oh, they were you know, particularly the historians. I don't know, you may not have read that much. We read it as architecture students. Historians will say things like, the skill of the craftspeople in Middle East, Far East, and Europe improved with time. In India, they kept replicating the cave architecture in monoliths and architecture of thatched buildings in stone. So they were very unimaginative. This is a fairly frequent charge that is given to the Indian craftsmen. The reality, symbolic people. We are a people who are very attached to symbolism and everything. And our philosophies, particularly the concepts which come from Vedanta, which is, say, the Jivatma and the Paramatma. Paramatma is the whole, and the Jivatma is a replication of the whole. simple theories like this become represented in the visual form. And that representation becomes very, very important as an identification. So when I create a temple for Vishnu, the identification of Vishnu and his cosmology, whether it was in a cave temple, in a brick structure, in a thatched structure, or a stone structure, this theme of the symbology will keep moving from one into the other.
You know, I actually find a couple of points that you made were fascinating. So from what I have understood or gathered by this history of the Shilpakars of our past is that unlike what you have today, it's like, you know, when you're going through a project today, so you have the architect that's doing the separate work. And then, you know, as they say, you have the kadiya who's doing something, and then there's someone who's managing the kadiya. And then... So today what we live in a world is it's more of specialization where, you know, everybody is supposed to be good at something. But while what we see from your explanation is the Indian way was completely different. I find it to be a lot of, I'm going to experiment a lot in a way. And there was also a learn on the job kind of an attitude.
Absolutely.
Would I be correct in analyzing that?
It would be learn on the job, but learn in your own yard, not on the actual job which is being funded by somebody else.
Yeah.
In the actual job, you will only be an assistant. You'll probably only sharpen the tools or, you know, you will only hang around behind the senior man.
And one more interesting thing that you mentioned, and I really loved this aspect, was that they kept on moving from one place to the other.
Yeah. Which
shows me that there was a beautiful free market at that time where
absolutely
could move from one place to the other and practice their craft and their talents in different areas where they were needed. And one thing I've always found this, please correct me if I'm wrong or dismiss my question itself, but you know, when I go to the West and when I look at their architecture and when I look at Indian architecture, I find 2-3 major differences. The Western architecture was always obsessed with big and magnanimity. And the Indian architecture is always into precision, the minutiae and the smaller detail. And one more feature that I found lacking in the Western architecture was the femininity. The Western architecture has no feminine. It is all masculine. I don't know if I'm right or wrong. Please correct me. What do you think?
I don't know whether it is the feminine. I would say sensuousness.
Okay.
That is the word I would use. Because for us, whether you take dance or music or architecture, the word Ramya is very important for us. And Ramya means aesthetic experience and sensuousness. And this comes from a joyous celebration of life. And that is a part of our life. It was not our tradition never said, give up everything and walk away. We were not the tradition of the ascetic. We were the tradition of the householder. And Grahastashrama actually means joyously celebrating life. Whether you're talking about nature or you're talking about children or you're talking about play, there is so much of enjoyment. And this, I think, is a very important aspect in the traditional architecture and sculpture. That's why you have these voluptuous forms, highly aesthetically carved forms. And in fact, what you're talking about, the feminine and masculine, very interesting parallel is there are three kinds of stones that they talk about, three kinds of wood that they talk about. It's the Strilingam, the Pullingam, and the Napumshakalingam.
Fascinating.
In all of them. So, the Purushashila is the masculine stone, is the one which has the densest kind of vibration and sound. And then the Strishila is the one which is medium, and Napumshaka does not resonate at all. So the Napumsaka Shila is used for construction. Sri Shila and Purusha Shila is used for the pillars and for the deity inside.
Wow.
Similarly for wood also.
So now, you know, see, this is where it gets very interesting for a guy like me. Now, let us take, for example, somebody from the West will pick up a textbook of Vastu Shastra and pick it up, and then they'll start going through the text, which is the standard way, right? You look at a text and you try to understand what the person is trying to say about that thing from the textual point of view. Now,
absolutely.
Who's the you? Now, what you have done is you have explained characteristics in a tangible object via gender pronouns. Now, if I was to be a, you know, a Westerner who comes from a very standard, you know, this is what I see, this is what I derive, this is what I see, this is what I derive. Now, they would, you know, they would bound, there is a huge possibility that they will get confused, and there is a chance of misinterpretation. So don't you think when it comes to explaining Vastu Shastra and, you know, talking about it, And I'll connect it to something. So please bear with me for a while. That people who talk about this, it has to be from a subject matter expert, not only a person who knows Vastu Shastra, but also someone who knows modern architecture. Because it could very well be that if, you know, a philosophy professor looks at this book and says, what the hell are they talking about? And a lot of it has also got to do with a lot of quackery that is being sold as Vastu Shastra today. Don't you think this is a combination of all of that?
Quite possibly. I also think it is because in the 80s, when I moved into the Vastu Shastra in 82, everybody thought I was mad. Nobody had even heard of the subject. But by the time the 90s came, there was a lot of feng shui in Vastu being brought into the market. And most of the people who got onto the bandwagon were the astrologers, because they saw a lot of money in it.
Yeah.
And what you're calling quackery is about the same time that you had medical quackery also. You had a period when through fear, through frightening people shitless, you could get them to give you money and make them believe anything. And I think that was a terrible time, because very quickly, this monochromatic, unilateral kind of belief system got established in people's minds. So even today, I mean, self-taught Vastu people will come to me as clients and say, yes, madam, I know. Unfortunately, my house has a toilet on the southwest. What can I do? I cannot change it, because of which I'm sure all of us are falling ill. They would have already done their diagnosis based on populist literature. And then I have to tell them, look, fundamentally, I don't believe in any of this, because I think the building is actually created out of material that does not think or feel. It may have energy, but it's at a very low grade, not with at the energy level of you and me, who are living organisms. Okay? So whatever energies are planted into the house, it is because of you and me. It is not because of themselves. So what are you attributing to the building itself? This is the reason why traditionally they said you have to do, when you move into a house which is already built, you had to go through a Ganapati Homam or a Sudarshana Homam to cleanse the space. Because you're not doing anything to the building. You're saying whoever lived here has left behind a hell of a lot of their thoughts, their sorrow, their pain, their anguish. Let this air be cleaned of that so that I might start my life again.
Now, here's the thing. Okay, now... obviously, like we had discussed offline, I'm going to try to play the role of the devil's advocate. I don't know if any, unfortunately.
Absolutely. Yeah. Go ahead.
Because so here's the guy, the materialist in me, when I start, you know, when my antennas come up, whenever people use words like, you know, when we use words like energy, or when we say, when I do X, X will result in ABC, now, all right, I'm open to it. And like I told you offline, I really want to learn. That's why I invited you, because I wanted to learn. I'm keen. Mm-hmm. I want to know more. And I love talking to people who know their subject. I have that humility. But when somebody makes a claim, don't you think that that claim somewhere down the line has to be quantifiable? So how would we today, if I would tell Vastu Shastra to the average, you know, consumer today in an honest, palatable way, not how the interior designer likes to do it. And in fact, sometimes I feel, I'll give you a story about North America, by the way. So in North America now, a lot of Hindu families, obviously, a lot of families from the subcontinent, they want to start buying houses that are Vastu compliant.
I know.
Okay.
I have now, clients too.
So now the brokers, and I'm not talking about just Indian brokers, I'm talking about the white brokers. They have found out, oh, these Indians have money and they like this thing called Vastu Shastra. They start charging more for properties that are Vastu compliant. Don't ask me how I know about this. I got family members who are real estate brokers in North America. That's why I found out about this story. And I was like, wow. I mean, so what happens is that you have a beautiful, you know, you beautiful system, which actually should be, even I as an atheist believe it should be preserved, because our, you know, a lot of artistry, a lot of culture is connected to this. Now, how do we draw that line where somebody who makes a claim about some changes leading to some, you know, energy changes, how do I quantify it? Because at the end of the day, a guy like me will always say, how do I prove it? Where's the proof? How do I measure this? Okay, if I cannot measure this, what is the abstract formulation that you can propose to me? So that's what I really wanted to talk to you about.
I can give it to you as an example.
All right.
Okay. Because it's very difficult for me to, on a 15 minute or a half an hour chat, to convince you totally. Okay. I can only try.
Yeah.
So many years ago, when I've done a lot of traveling all over the world, and I have taught and I have also tried to help people in their homes. And one of the reasons people come to for Vastu correction or for alternate healing or whatever is because they are in sorrow. Let me start from there, Kushal. It is not because they're just coming there to have a fun and games. Invariably, they are suffering. Okay. So there was this young woman who was in my class in Perth. And a very, very interesting young woman. And she had a lot of background with Muktananda Ashram. And she'd been through gurus. And she was in a lot of pain, a lot of sorrow. So she took me to her house and she told me that every night she was getting nightmares and would wake up sweating and hurting and weep like hell. And it was going on for weeks on end. So she said, can you help me in some way or the other? So I went around and I do a lot of meditative work. And I also do work with a pendulum and energy work and so on. So I went around the home. I checked the sensed the energies in rooms, this, that, and the other. At the end of it, I told her, I'm not picking up anything because I'm not one of those who will manufacture and make people do things because I, you know, I want to make the money. I'm not like that.
You're so a bad businesswoman.
A very bad businesswoman. That's why I don't have any clients. So I told her there is nothing happening here. I think it's a good place. Then she said, how do you explain it? So, sometimes I have, you know, feeling of suffocation, somebody sitting on my stomach, this, that. Then I asked her about her diet because that's the other thing I do. I check out what are their food habits, what is their health like, do they exercise and all the rest of it. So that I also rule out the practical pragmatics of their lifestyle. Went through everything. All clear. Then I said, let's just walk around the property. It was an independent house in a fairly large property. She was a landscape designer. So she was doing a lot of landscape work in her garden. And she had moved from South Africa. And while she was talking, she also narrated she had come out of a bad marriage, abusive marriage, a family where there was a lot of physical abuse, her parents, her father, her brothers, and so on. So it's a woman with a very tragic background and history. So I was actually internally wondering whether all that was catching up with her, you know, that she was having these bad dreams and she'd come away from home, etc. Then I walked around the garden, and I usually tell people not to walk with me because I allow that space to speak to me. So I was just walking around, and suddenly at one place, I was completely transfixed and I felt a lot of pain, lot of anger. And I just said, what the hell is going on? And I just stood there, and there was an elderly gardener working in her garden. He was a local man. And I asked him, what is it? What's happening to this place? So then he related to me the history of that space. Apparently, during the colonial period, that was a place where much of the slaughter of the locals happened. The aboriginals were slaughtered in that land and buried there. So it is possible that there was a lot of their pain still hanging around in that space. It is possible. I don't know. I picked it up. My body picked it up. And then I was told this. So there was very little I could do after that. I told this lady, this girl, that I am a strong believer in what is in the puja tradition called yantra, mantra and tantra, where you place an object, a sacred object, you chant or you do mantra japa, and then you also create a activity pattern, a tantra, a routine around this, a practice around this. So I told her, and usually it's done for one mandala. So I told her, pick up, and the mandala is usually between 42 to 49 days. Some people say 42, some say 47, some say 49. So I told her, take one mandala and use this spot where I was standing. It was very close to a beautiful old tree. So I said, use this beautiful tree and do your chanting every day. Whatever chant comes to you, it could be, because she was a Muktananda student. So I said, it can just be Om Namah Shivaya if you want, or it could be just Om, whatever it is, 108 times. And then chant it to some water and pour the water to the tree. And while you're doing it, just say, may this land be healed of all its pain. And I was there only for 4 or 5 days after that. She didn't get in touch with me, but I have a feeling it would have changed. Because many instances I have known where just putting in your intent and connecting with a space, planting a tree, planting a flower, working with sacred water, can change your relationship with that space. Energy is only that relationship. Nothing more mystical than that. You and that relationship have a new, you and that space have a new relationship.
Okay, then if somebody would say that, obviously we can't measure this, then could it also be classified that was a placebo? Again, I'm just asking questions, so I hope you take it in that sense.
Placebo today, if you have been watching and reading the new material, placebo is being seen as a very powerful tool.
I agree.
Because you're actually using your own energy to shift from a state of pain into a state of joy.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, I am completely with you. In fact, I believe that placebo should be given official recognition as a proper healing method too. But But then it should be called what it is, and people should be told what it is all about. But
yeah,
otherwise, under the garb of placebo, like I said, I don't know how to put it, but not everybody is going to be as honest as you, Shashikala. Like I said, you're a bad businesswoman. what happens is the moment we enter these areas where, you know, we do this, we do that, and you use the very good example. You said a lot of astrologers are getting into this, which yeah. I think is the worst thing that could have happened to our society, because they just saw an opening, and, you know, it's the worst thing you can do to a person is exploit them when they are down. I mean, that's the worst thing you can do to them. Now, in your case, you're not exploiting them. I mean, you're doing the opposite, actually. You're letting them exploit you in a way by giving them free services, you know, by giving them consultancy without a cost. But what the fear I have is that, you know, when these kinds of things happen, that, you know, a lot of people are going to exploit it. And that's why, you know, it is important to call it out. Now let us move into the details of Vastu Shastra. So here's the thing. Imagine I am someone who comes to you and says, okay, Shashikala, I want to build a house. Now I live in the 21st century. Now, how would I use the best of the 21st century methods and the best of Vastu Shastra, and you're my consultant, take me through the process and build a house for me? That's my only question to you now.
There are several aspects that I'll have to explain before I go into the design part. Vastu Shastra talks about three kinds of building. One is Srishti Vastu. Though this a concept is there in the books, the words have been coined by me. That I have to admit. I'm not saying the words are there in the text. Srishti Vastu means newly constructing a house. Okay? Then there is Vardhamana Vastu. Vardhamana means addition.
Okay.
Or correction. There is a building, you want to add another floor, you want to extend it, you want to change it. Okay? Or you're going to restore it to its old glory. All that comes under Vardhamana. The third is Chikitsa. Chikitsa literally means healing, therapy. So, there is a feeling of unwellness or feeling of grief or discomfort or ill health experienced in a particular home, and you're helping them to change it.
Right.
Okay. So, all three I work with. Though today, Srishti Vastu, I'm not doing so much because I don't have an office going, and it's very difficult on your own. Then there is also three other aspects that come into it, which is Bhogadyam, Sukhadarsham or Sukhadarshanam, and Ramya. Bhogadyam means that which is utilitarian. So if you want a refrigerator, there should be a place that you can place the refrigerator in today's terminology. Old times, you had a swing, you needed something on which you can hang the swing. So it should be utilitarian, it should be practical. That is Bhogadyam. Sukhadarsham or Sukhadarshanam is aesthetics. So today, when people call it Vastu compliant and they are making it into a little box with absolutely no aesthetic sensibility, I have a feeling people will die of this thing of spirit there, you know, boredom of spirit in those homes. Because aesthetics has always played a very important role in our tradition, which is why I called it sensuousness.
Yeah.
You have the textures must, you should be able to touch the textures. You should be able to respond to the color. You should be able to look at the proportion and the aesthetics of a space and feel glad. I mean, the size of a room, the height of the wall must all have an impact on your mind and your emotions. So all this will play a part. So I would say all six are important as a designer for me. So you come to me with your postmodern sensibility, and then you say to me, this is what I am looking for. I will ask you about your aesthetic sensibility. I will talk to you about the materials that you are interested in. And I'll also warn you about the so-called modern materials which are pushing out toxic chemicals or gases into the atmosphere. Would you like to make a choice of traditional materials like baked earth, bricks, you know, things like that, rather than plastics and things like that, just because it is modern? And then colors that you would like. And then I'll also give you some specifications about what is considered critical in a built form. What are the very, very important aspects of a built form? Like, for example, I'll just tell you one or two of them because there are too many of them.
Okay.
The central point of your building is known as the Brahmasthana. And the Brahmasthana is a very important aspect of a home, how it is treated. So if you have a wall or a pillar, it actually works on your own physical body because the house becomes an extension of yourself. There is a feeling of actually suffocation. This I have worked with enough clients. I have enough data on this. Wherever the central point in a home has been built upon, as a pillar or a wall, there is tremendous amount of health issues in that home.
Interesting.
Because it seems to affect the body, actually responds to the body of the house, of the building.
Okay.
And you talked about North America. In North America in particular, particularly the suburban houses, if you remember your visits to them, they always have a toilet in the center of the house. Have you noticed it?
Yes.
You come through the mudroom, you come through the...
Yeah,
and then there will be a little toilet right plonk in the center of the house.
Yes.
And I became very unpopular because I told a lot of people who asked me in North America, I told them, chances are that you have piles, you know, that you have... digestion and problems with your defecation. Invariably they have. Because it seems to affect digestion.
As far as food habits of today's people are concerned, I think most of the world is going to suffer from that. Yeah.
Hemorrhoids. Hemorrhoids is a big thing.
Yeah. So the millennials are experts at indigestion, the amount of bad food they are consuming.
Yeah, yeah.
So
no, but this is a, these are all principles that have been talked about. So I will explain it to the client.
Yeah.
Because it's my job to explain it. You need not go for it. You need not believe in it. But yeah, it's my job to explain it to you. So I'll say to you, please don't ask me to place anything in the middle, which is why they opened it out, you see, courtyard.
Yeah.
Because the energies have to move freely between the earth and the sky. When it is blocked, it causes health problems.
Okay. Now, one more question, you know, while you were explaining this. Now, you know, a lot of times, okay, you live in rural India or you live in, you know, small towns in India, still space, you know, space is not that much of a constraint. Now, I get that. I mean, North America space is never a constraint. I mean, they're just with space. You go to Australia. I recently went to Australia. I was like, damn, you know, and look at them and look at us. You know, we have no space. Now, I'm from Mumbai. Now, Mumbai, you can't probably even do this in a room. You can't even spread your arms around. That's how bad it is. Now, how does a person who lives in Mumbai, Delhi, or Pune for that matter, you know, cramped rooms, cramped houses. So what would they, you know, if you tell them, I mean, to come and say, so I'll tell you, nowadays in Mumbai, the builders are like, this building is Vastu compliant. I know that. So they do that. But the point is, now I'm stuck here, right? I am in Mumbai. So what would you tell to a person who comes to you from a big, bustling urban structure? That's my second follow-up to you.
Here I will, like I told you, remember that I always talk to people about their health, their food habits, and their personal lifestyles. So what I do is I help them to reconfigure their relationship with themselves and the space they occupy. So it's a very experiential thing. You actually teach them to start by saying, okay, this is your bed. You get up from it. This is the relationship you have with your bed and yourself. You get up and you look around in the four walls. What is it about that room which makes you feel sad, angry, feeling claustrophobic, feeling free? So you help them to nurture the free part of themselves. Maybe using color, maybe using shape, maybe using fresh flowers. There are various ways in which this inner prison, you know, the feeling of being in a prison can be opened out. Many aesthetic ways in which it can be done. And then there are also little aids that we talk about. There is this thing called the Navaratna Sthapana.
All right.
So in the Brahmasthana, like I told you, the Brahmasthana is blocked and you're stuck. You've paid 1 crore for that house. You're stuck in it. How can you change it? You don't sell the house and walk away, right? Mm-hmm. So there is a way through activating your energies of healing, which is possible, and using the Navaratna pieces and placing it in a particular location and then moving into what I told you, mantra, yantra and tantra.
All right.
Where you're actually psyching or creating a new intention for yourself. And so activating the space you inhabit in a different way.
Okay, so would it be safe if I were to, so whatever I have grasped now from after my conversation with you now for a while. So if somebody came to me and said, you know, what is Vastu Shastra? I would I be in a safe zone and say, when I tell them that Vastu Shastra is not just about how you build your house or what artifacts you add to your house. Vastu Shastra is a lifestyle. It's how you live your life and what aspects of your life you incorporate, and the place where you stay, the house you have is part of that lifestyle. And it is more like, you know, how much are you in touch with yourself too as a person? Because now what happens today is everybody is at a very superficial level. Like, you know, you mentioned colors. Now, how many people even bother every third house you go in India, you'll either see a black, like a white wall or a beige colored wall. At most, some people get funky and get a red color or they put some paint. But they, like I always say, I don't have the brains to decipher that. I mean, I'm speaking right now from my house. I mean, the wall behind me is wheatish. But I did not even use my brain in that because like I'm not going to say I know anything, so I'll just go by whatever the flow is. But what you're trying to say is that when somebody looks at Vastu Shastra, it should be more like a lifestyle and less like a go to me, come to me, solve the problem kind of a thing.
That is one aspect. The other aspect which I am very particular to mention when I meet a client is that I am in the game of empowering you. I'm not in the game of getting you to become addicted to me.
Yeah.
I want you to be able to recreate, re-anchor, re-energize your own spaces. I will teach you the ways.
Okay.
So I believe that every human being has a capacity to interact with their own space.
All right.
And I teach them how to do it.
That's perfect. But again, like I said, the conclusion would be bad business strategy.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So basically what we can conclude is that that if you are someone who has just found out about Vastu Shastra, what you should try to do is it should not only be Vastu Shastra. And that's why, you know, when I read your introduction, that a very important aspect was that whenever you conduct workshops, that is with Raghu and Raghu and you, both of you conduct workshops, and Raghu is an expert in the yoga section, the philosophy of yoga. So it's not just Vastu Shastra, it's, you know, the philosophy of yoga, the lifestyle along with Vastu Shastra and certain principles and fair enough, you could be skeptical about certain claims of certain aspects of Vastu Shastra, but if you follow a good lifestyle, I think the end product ends up being quite palatable and quite positive.
Absolutely. You can recharge the space to suit your inner energies, inner movements, inner desires.
Fair enough. So I guess this is a perfect way. So, you know, everybody, so a message to the listeners now from my end. So you have to understand my aim of doing this conversation. And, Shashikala and I have been going back and forth. We have been having a lot of emails and we were not able to fix a time. But A, I'm very happy that I finally got to do this with her. But try and understand now, and a lot of people who watch me, you know, you might be having a certain image or a certain, you know, concept about what I am and what I do. And I always try to make it a point that, you know, I will talk to people who I find interesting. And when I say I find interesting, I don't have to agree with anyone 100%. But via my channel, I am not trying to put down Indian traditions. That is the last thing I want to do. All I'm trying to do is revive Indian traditions and make them relevant in today's context, where there is a huge amount of evidence coming out of science. So don't classify me as the average atheist, and don't classify me as the old Charvaka either. I'm maybe something which is between the both of them. And I'm really thankful to you, Shashikala, that, you know, you've come and, you know, you've spoken about this. And I'm hoping a lot of people watch this. And even if one person is able to understand Vastu Shastra out of this, and one Jyotish runs out of business, I will be a very happy man.
Thank you.
So thanks a lot. And I hope we do this again when we touch upon some theoretical concepts, because I did not want to get into a lot of theory today, but we'll do it some other day where we might, you know, get into the theoretical concepts. So once again, thanks a lot, Shashikala.
Thank you.
Yeah,
okay. Bye.